Hello everyone, I would like to welcome you to our e-mobility webinar. The agenda for today is the following. We will talk about why do we measure power in electric vehicles. In the first part of the webinar, my colleague Darren will take you through the setup of the power module in the DVSoft software and various aspects of the voltage and current signal acquisition. We will then go into the e-mobility demonstration with our 8-channel XHS and talk about some aspects of the in-vehicle measurements. In the end, we will show you how the superheroes do it. Any electric powertrain component starts as a concept on the drawing board and makes its way through a design and simulation process into reality. To evaluate the reality against the design and simulations, comprehensive testing and measurements are vital. To that end, test engineers need to carefully consider the complete measurement setup, from the selection of sensors for acquisition of different signals to the acquisition device and the analysis of the acquired data in the software. This happens on multiple stages, both on a single component level and finally on the finished product level. Today we are going to take you through all the stages of the testing process. I will now invite my colleague Darren to talk more about why do we need to measure power in the first place.
We are always up for a challenge.
Thank you, Urban. Welcome, everybody. Thank you for joining us this afternoon. Let's get right into it. Why do we measure power in electric vehicles? Well, to make these vehicles as efficient as possible. The biggest challenge currently faced in the e-mobility market is to increase the range of the vehicles to be able to compete with their combustion engine counterparts. Efficiency simply means extended range. It is a simple math problem. The amount of power that the system delivers divided by the amount of power that had to be added to the system to deliver said power is my efficiency. But is it actually that easy? Well, no, it's not. So, how do you keep the amount of power input as low as possible while extracting as much as power as possible? By doing extensive research and development on test benches as well as in real drive testing on these electric vehicles. This is to ensure that all the components in the vehicle are as efficient as possible, both as single components and as a whole system. To get there, we have to measure the input to the system as well as the output of the system and decide where to go to work. For example, by just increasing the amount of energy fed into the system, for instance, by just adding more batteries, it has the adverse effect that there is more weight added to the car. Funny how these things walk hand in hand. So, this will for sure increase the amount of power that we have available, but it will also increase the power to weight ratio, not really helping us much. It will also increase the cost of the vehicle production, as the battery system is the most expensive part of the drivetrain. So where do we start? There are two main avenues that we can take into consideration to increase the efficiency of an electric vehicle. Let's have a look at them. So we can start with the overall vehicle design, excuse me. We reduce all vehicle resistances. This includes vehicle mass, vehicle cross-section, the drag coefficients, and the rolling resistance coefficients. This can be done in various ways. We reduce the payload. What does that mean? We have a smaller vehicle. We can also reduce the crash zone. That means less safety for the vehicle. Or we can reduce the auxiliary energy consumption, which basically means removing all of the comfort. We don't want to do that. So what can we do? Well, we focus on the electrical components. And this is where DVSoft comes in. We increase the overall vehicle efficiency by increasing the efficiency of the electrical components working together. This means the evaluation of the complete drivetrain, including the auxiliary components. As previously shown, these directly influence the energy consumption of the complete system. This means finding the appropriate combination and dimensions for the components of the drivetrain. As can be seen from the table on the screen, all the components have efficiency thresholds in which they have to operate. The goal here is to identify the components where the efficiency can be increased. Once we have identified where the power in the system is lost, we can evaluate which components have to be looked at closer to increase the overall efficiency of our system. So where should we measure? Well, in order to assess the amount of power that is consumed by the system, it's also imperative to measure the main consumers and the losses that we have in our system, as these play a large role in the overall consumption of the vehicle itself. Energy within the system is limited, and we want to utilize every single cell of energy that we have available as best we can. So we have multiple main power consumption units in our vehicle, which operate at different voltages and currents, which need to be measured. We need to measure the power that's delivered to the actual vehicle, so the input from our charging system. We need to measure how much of this electrical power actually gets delivered to the battery. Then we need to measure how much power is delivered from the power distribution unit to our auxiliary units, to our frequency inverter, to the radio, the consumption of low voltage consumers such as the radio. We need to do other auxiliary consumers that take a lot of power, such as the heater or the AC when it's hot. And we need to measure then the overall drivetrain power as a complete system. These are just a few of the main consumers that influence the overall efficiency of our vehicle. Another fact is that we have multiple application areas. Usually when we think of electric vehicles, we usually only think of battery-powered electric vehicles. But there are other vehicle types which are also classified as electric vehicles, such as hybrid and hydrogen-powered vehicles. There are also different drivetrain topologies, as we can see. We have single motor, dual motor, and in-wheel motors for electric vehicles. With the modularity and flexibility of Devasoft devices, we can measure them all, and then some. For hybrid vehicle analysis, we can combine the power module and the combustion analyzer from Devasoft to work congruently for an optimal hybrid vehicle measurement. So what does the Devasoft power analyzer actually bring to the table? Well, the power analyzer from Devasoft combines multiple instruments in a single product, such as a power analyzer, or oscilloscope, a FFT analyzer, a power quality analyzer, a transient recorder, a data logger, and a powerful post-processing tool. This is because Devasoft has the ability to store all raw data at the full sampling rate. So when a certain parameter or calculation was forgotten during the measurement, it can be added post-measurement and recalculated. This eliminates the need to redo measurements. Let's quickly look over the power module itself within the Devasoft software. How do I actually select the power module? Well, to add the new power module, click on the plus button on the main dashboard, then click on the power analysis button. By doing this, the power icon will be available on the main dashboard. You then click on the power button on the main dashboard, and you will be taken to the setup screen. So the power module also allows measurements of different power configurations needed for a variety of market segments, whether they're using DC, AC, constant or variable frequency, or a combination of them. So now we see our setup screen. I have color-coded the sections for a better overview. Let's go through them. In purple, you'll see the number of modules that you have open in the software. You can have multiple modules working congruently at the same time, and these can be configured to fit any measurement. Green, number one, indicates if the power module is actually being used, if it's unused, or if it's set on offline. There's, number two is the setup screen, as you see it on the screen, or it can also show the channel list. And number three is for renaming the power module to whatever you like. In the yellow, this is our configuration of the power module, whether you want to measure DC or AC. But you can do your line frequency, whether 50 or 60 hertz, or variable frequencies for measurements in inverters like you do with electric cars. It also shows the output units in watts, watt hours, or megawatts, and also allows you to enter the nominal voltage. In red, this is the wiring schematic. This is for assigning the current and voltage channels that you want to measure on this wiring schematic. In magenta, we have the measurement parameter options, such as power calculations, energy calculations, and power quality calculations. There's also a vectorscope preview, which is very, very helpful to see if voltages and currents are connected correctly, especially when you are measuring multiple phases. And in blue, we have the different options that are available for the various measurement parameters in magenta. Next, we'll have a look at our measurement screen setups that we have available. For a DC measurement, this is actually quite simple. For DC, you just connect your positive wire to the high voltage and the negative wire to the high voltage black amplifier, stick on your current clamp, and you're ready to measure. But please pay attention, never calculate DC power using the one-phase power module. This would not work, and it will absolutely yield incorrect results. Then we have a single-phase measurement. It's very much the same as a DC measurement. From the connection here, you just add your neutral line to the black low of the high voltage and your line voltage to the red of the high voltage, and add your current clamp, and you're ready to measure. For a three-phase star measurement setup, so the star measurement connection is mainly used for measuring three-phase systems, especially if a neutral line from a star point of the motor is available. The three-phase voltages are connected to the series high volt modules as shown in on the high voltage side, and then the low voltage side of the three inputs is on the potential of the neutral line of the motor star point. If both are not available, an artificial star point can be created by short-circuiting the low sides of the amplifiers. Starting with the delta measurement setup, the delta connection is used in the absence of a neutral line or a star point on a motor. The three-phase voltages are connected to the series high voltage amplifiers, the red ones, as you can see in the schematic. And then the neutral terminals of the high voltage amplifiers must be connected to the next live terminal. This means the neutral terminal from L1 has to be connected to the live terminal of L2, the neutral terminal of L2 to the live terminal of L3, and then the neutral terminal of L3 all the way back to the live terminal of L1. So, coming to our measurement screen, Datasoft already has predefined screens for our users that can be customized to the wiring diagram that has been chosen for the measurement option. These include recorder screens, power value screens, power scopes, power vectors, and power harmonics. When you click on a visualization within Datasoft, you will automatically have the channels that can be used with the said visualization automatically shown on the right-hand side. And on the left-hand side, you have all the options for that visualization. The most relevant visualizations that we use for power analysis are digital meters, which depict the different values calculated by the power module in numerically. We have the recorder that depicts power values in a chart. Then we have the scope, which depicts waveforms and voltages as an oscilloscope does. Then we have the vectorscope, as we discussed earlier, which depicts the relationship between the voltages and the currents, including the phase angles. Then we also have the FFT analyzer. This depicts time domain acquired data in the frequency domain. And you can also add many, many others, such as video and GPS as well. Now, adding a custom screen, all you have to do is click on the displays button on the main dashboard. This will open the manage displays menu. Click on the plus button to add a display, and once this has been completed, the screens can be renamed, custom icons can be used, and multi-monitor setups can be done. In setting up a custom screens can be constructed to fit the individual needs of the measurement or the user, and of course, all of the predefined screens from Datasoft can also be altered at any time. Now, we're coming to a multi-phase AC measurement. This is actually quite interesting, as all the most common configuration setups are available in the Datasoft power module, but especially in electric vehicle setups, there are applications and configurations for 6, 7, 9, or even 12 phase motors needed. There can be various reasons for this, as lowering the voltage level or reducing the stress on the components. Now, with conventional power analyzers, there is no way to do a comprehensive analysis of such motors. But with the modular hardware design of Datasoft, In combination with our powerful software, these types of applications do not present any type of challenge. So with only two serious modules, a seven-phase motor, and the DC power that drives it, can be analyzed simultaneously. So how do we actually do this? Well, all you do is you use seven single-phase power modules, and by calculating the total power, is just adding them up in the math library. Now for energy calculations, this is actually quite interesting, because in Datasoft, you can actually get all the energy calculations done automatically using the power module. And what you get calculated is the total energy as well as the positive energy, so the energy consumption from the system, and the negative energy, so the energy delivered back into the system. This is especially helpful when measuring electric vehicles with recuperation, so energy recovery vehicles. Now let's have a quick look at our voltage amplifiers. What do we have? Datasoft has direct voltage inputs up to 1600 volts DC for the high speed unit and up to 2 kilovolts DC for the XHS unit. But both of these units have CAT 3 1000 volt and CAT 2 600 volt safety ratings. They both have an accuracy of 0.03% of reading, and the sampling rate for the high speed up to 1 megasample per second, and the XHS up to 15 megasamples per second. Now we get to the more interesting part, the current measurements. So these are current transducers, which you see on your screen at the moment. So what is a current transducer? Well, current transducer is a device that converts alternating or direct electrical signals into a proportional industrial standard electrical signal. A simple current transducer can be broken down into four main components, namely a power circuit, a conversion unit, a conversion circuit, and a sense component. So as the current flows, the sense component will detect the signal. It then passes the conversion unit, where the measured signal is converted into a parameter that the measurement device then measures. For electric vehicle measurements, high accuracy and high bandwidth is very important, and that is why we'll be concentrating on the flux gate transducers as well as zero flux transducers. Next, here's a nice matrix overview of which current transducers we can use for which applications. As we're working with both direct current as well as alternating current in electric vehicle systems, we would like to mostly offer a current transducer which can both measure your alternating and direct current. The best suited for electric vehicle measurements, as seen in the matrix, are the zero flux and the flux gate transducers. Let's have a quick closer look at these two technologies. So here we have the zero flux transducer, which has many advantages. It has extremely high bandwidth, up to 800 kilohertz. It has the highest amplitude accuracy of in the parts per million range. We have a very low phase error, lowest offset error. There's galvanic isolation, but it does come with disadvantages, which is the price. And if you want to measure an electric vehicle, you have to open the circuits to insert the wires through the transducer and close your circuits again. Then we go over to our flux gate clamps. These have many advantages as well. It also has very high bandwidth, up to 500 kilohertz, very high accuracy, below 0.3%. It has a broad temperature range, which is good for summer and winter testing, from minus 40 to 65 degrees Celsius. There's a low phase error and offset error, as well as galvanic isolation. There are many disadvantages to these clamps, but basically they're quite expensive. Now, most of the current transducers offered by Datasoft can be powered directly from the low voltage amplifier, but there are transducers that need a little extra power. So as the zero flux and the flux gate transducers are the two that need this extra power. So therefore, we developed the Sirius Power NZTS. Let's have a quick look at this unit. So some current transducers, as I mentioned before, need a little more power, and the low voltage amplifiers cannot provide this. So here we need the Sirius Power NZTS. The Power NZTS is the most compact power supply for transducers on the market today. There are 4-channel and 8-channel high density units available, and both of these modules are also available in rack versions. The high-density module has a slightly lower power output at about 15 watts per channel compared to the 4-channel unit, which has 20 watts per channel. To demonstrate all of the information that you have just received and how it comes together, I will now hand over to my colleague Urban, who will do an electric vehicle measurement demonstration using the XHS, new 8-channel XHS at 15 mega samples per second. Enjoy.
Here, I will demonstrate the full capability of the Sirius XHS 8-channel version with 4 times high voltage and 4 times low voltage inputs in combination with the power module. What we have here is the well-known e-mobility demonstration kit where we will be measuring output voltage and currents from the battery to the inverter and output voltages and currents from the inverter to the motor. Since the neutral of the motor is not accessible, we will be measuring the voltages in delta configuration. The laptop that we are using has an i9 processor with 32 gigabytes of RAM and an NVIDIA RTX 2070 GPU with 8 gigabytes of dedicated memory. As for the software, we are using the recently released GPU accelerated version of the power module. And we will show you how it can perform the real-time analysis of power at full sample rate that the Sirius XHS supports. First, to enable the GPU acceleration, I need to go to the options and settings and go to the power module settings here. The power analysis settings. Here I need to enable the GPU acceleration. As you can see here, it's already enabled. And I will also allow the toggling of the GPU acceleration, which will enable me to select or deselect the GPU acceleration on the actual power module for each particular module. I will now close these settings and go to the setup. As you can see in the channel setup, I have 15 mega samples per second acquisition rate. So these ranges and everything are set properly already. And we'll go to the power module setup. Here I'm having 2 power modules, one for the DC power. So this will enable us to analyze power from the battery to the inverter, and one for the motor power, which where we will be measuring power from the inverter to the motor. As you can see, we're using the delta wiring, we need to select the frequency as variable frequency, since we know that here the drive has a frequency range from, let's say, 10 hertz to about 300 hertz. We'll set this to 800 just to be safe and close these settings. What you need to note here also is that we've now enabled the number of cycles setting for the variable frequency, which now determines the cycle count for each output value of the power module. So this was previously not enabled in the CPU version of the power module, but is now present in the GPU version. So as for the other settings, I will enable the line voltages, and I'll also enable the power quality, so harmonics. 100 is proper for this case, is enough. And as you can see here, I have a checkbox here to enable or disable the GPU acceleration. If I enable it, I also have the calculation rate divider here in settings, which in this case we will not be using since we want to do the analysis at full sample rate. If I now go to measure, the DevSoft will initiate measurement, and the measurement is already running at 15 mega samples, and also, of course, the analysis. I will now power on the remote just to see if this works. It does. Okay. And here we go. And as you can see, we are running the analysis at 15 mega samples. Okay, I want to warn you that if you want to be storing at this high sample rate, you need a fast solid state drive and also enough of it, because the data rate is really quite high and it will fill up your disk quite fast.
So hello again. In this next part, we will take a closer look at in-vehicle measurements. So in in-vehicle measurements, we are moving from a single component testing to more system-wide testing. It is normally the case that the particular components were tested in isolation before the integration, and it is now the case that we want to evaluate them in a complete system or at least in an integrated subsystem. So for example, we want to evaluate the complete drivetrain efficiency as close to the wheels as possible. In component testing, the efficiency of a particular component is already determined. Now, if something changes, normally the component goes back to the test bench, and in most cases, it is hard to, because in most cases it is hard to access certain areas in the integrated subsystem. For example, on the image right, you can see the drivetrain of the Tesla with a motor, inverter, and a gearbox integrated into a single part. So in this case, we cannot access the part between the inverter and the motor to measure the, let's say, the output currents of the inverter. As we're looking at the complete system, we might be interested in measurements beside power. So, for example, we might be interested if the motor currents that cause vibrations due to electromagnetic force that induce some high pitch noise, which may be disturbing to the driver and the surroundings. So we might want to measure some extra NVH parameters and also temperature in some cases. So the in-vehicle measurements normally require higher levels of safety and integration. The device needs to have an extended temperature range, since a vehicle can be tested in summer and winter conditions. Obviously, ruggedness is a factor. The device needs to be able to withstand dust, water, and shock. And also, in some cases, we might have multiple motor configurations, which also means multiple inverters. Of course, DC connections from the battery to the inverters. Of course, the system needs to be able to scale up and to collect all these measurements and sync them. So another aspect of the in-vehicle measurements are the auxiliary systems, as Darren mentioned before. We might want to measure the consumption on the HVAC system or on the entertainment system and so on. So in short, those measurement requirements are covered by the XHS power. The device can measure up to 2000 volts voltage and up to 1000 amps of current and up to 2000 amps of peak current. So the next revision that is coming out will also support the direct connection of the cables. So for now, the cables were pre-installed for the specific customer with the connectors mounted onto the cables. But it will now be possible to also add basically any kind of cable. With any kind of connector. So the thing that is going to be that we're going to also enable is the high voltage interlock. High voltage interlock is a mechanism that, in case of the connector disconnection or opening of the high voltage compartment, the device signals the shutdown of the power supply. This is important in cases where we have let's say, large current flowing through the system. And since the motor has quite a large inductance, the disconnection would cause the actually fire and the connector destruction. So the power supply needs to be turned off before someone disconnects the connectors on the measurement equipment. The device is compliant with the 61010 low voltage directive and is powered through the power over Ethernet connection. So it also supports the PTP synchronization. So basically, we have only one cable that is that connects to the device, so that brings data, power, and also synchronization. I won't go into more detail about the device, since there will be a separate webinar on all the features that the device offers. We have prepared a short teaser video that will show the XHS power in action. Just before that, another important thing here maybe to mention is that the XHS power measures the current in a conductor without the shield. So the shield itself is removed, is circumvented through the DCCT technology. And the shield, because the shield itself can influence the measurement by displacing the phase of the signal and also smoothing out the signal itself. So we sort of have some low pass filtering between the conductor and its and the shield. So for accurate measurement, for accurate AC measurements, it is good that the shield is removed, and this is the case in the XHS power. So here you see a typical setup that you would use in a single motor electric vehicle. We are going to be measuring the output power of the battery to the inverter using the XHS power, and the output voltages and currents of the inverter to the motor using the A-channel XHS. As promised at the beginning of the webinar, we are now going to show you how the superheroes do it. Please enjoy the video.
Hello everyone. We are here at an undisclosed location where the development for the new Batman motorcycle is in progress. Since Batman wants to make as little noise as possible, the team developed an electric bike. And to see how the prototype behaves on a dyno, they've called Divisoft for help. We are excited to show you what our solutions in e-mobility segment can do. What we have here is an electric bike with an in-wheel three-phase motor that will deliver up to 120 kilowatts of power and up to 1,500 newton meters of torque. This will accelerate the motor up to 100 kilometers an hour in under 3 seconds, and the motor has range of 250 kilometers. Motor itself is supplied through a single inverter that is powered by a battery system at 400 volts, and we've put our brand new XHS power in between the battery system and the inverter. To investigate the dynamic behavior of the inverter, we've used our Sirius XHS to measure the output currents and voltages of the inverter.
Sirius XHS, measurement solution for superheroes.